Good afternoon, and thank you all for being here. We're going to have an interactive presentation, which means we will be asking you guys to participate as well in this process. And our topic for today is interprofessional education and practice, IPE, preparing future psychologists for integrated healthcare. The outline of our presentation will include, first of all, we'll do some quick introductions, and then we will talk a little bit about what is IPE and its role in integrated healthcare. We'll do a description of the Ignite program, which we will describe to you shortly. And then we're going to just spend a little bit of time talking about, can such a program be replicated in your own school setting? Okay? So that's the plan for this this afternoon. My name is Alvin McLean, and I am a professor at John F. Kennedy University and also the co-director of clinical training. And I'll be kicking off the presentation. And
my name is Joy Marquez. I am a student at John F. Kennedy University in the clinical PsyD program. And I'm also a student enrolled in the Ignite program.
And I'm Sukie Magraw. I'm faculty at JFK University, co-director of training with Alvin McLean, and I am a faculty member with this interprofessional education experience.
Thank you. So, how many of you actually know what IPE is? Anyone? Just a show of hands. Very good. IPE has been around for quite a while, but it's been formally framed up by the Center for Advancement of Interprofessional Education. And the definition they use is interprofessional education occurs when two or more professions learn with, from, and about each other to improve collaboration and quality of care. This process, in turn, leads to what is considered in integrated healthcare circles as collaborative interprofessional practice. And we're going to delve into that in just a moment. The World Health Organization in 2010 actually did some seminal work in the area of IPE, and they published a manuscript called Framework for Action, Interprofessional Education and Collaborative Practice. And they delineated a number of real benefits from IPE training, and those include as a process of doing IPE training with healthcare professionals in an integrated healthcare setting, it actually resulted in a reduction in hospital length of stays, and also a reduction in ED visits within hospitals, resulted in improvements in quality of life for the patients as measured by measures of, given to the actual patients, the clients, and their families. It resulted in improved access to care for the patients. It showed significant improvements in patient safety. And in fact, one of the real takeaways is that it not only resulted in clinical and economic improvements, but it also improved job satisfaction for the healthcare providers and resulted in enhanced recruitment and retention of healthcare providers as well. So it had a number of really positive effects of engaging in interprofessional education. The program that we're going to be talking about today is called the Ignite program. It is interprofessional group near-peer integrated team education. And this is a truly collaborative partnership between three universities to work to train their students in how to work as an interprofessional team. The universities involved include the joint medical program of University of California, San Francisco, and UC Berkeley, the medical students there, the Semiahmerit University, which is one of the larger nursing programs in the Bay Area. In addition to the basic RN nursing degrees, they also have nurse practitioner degrees, doctorate in nursing practice, physician assistant, occupational therapy, physical therapy, as well as a doctorate in podiatric medicine, and certified nurse anesthetist degree. And of course, John F. Kennedy University, which produces a PsyD degree. Not only are the interprofessional students involved in this training, but the entire faculty for the course is also interprofessional. It includes physicians from the GMP program, nurse practitioners and nurse anesthetists, and physical therapists from the Semi-Merit University program, and of course, this, myself and Dr. Magraw from the JFK program. So what are the essential elements of interprofessional education? As you might suspect, it is focused on learning together in a collaborative environment where the every team member is working together, learning each other's roles and responsibilities as healthcare providers, breaking down barriers in communication, which is an essential part of the IPE process and makes a significant difference in terms of overall patient care, and improving communication across the students from different health disciplines. And as Joyce talks about some of the team steps, she'll be able to tell you a little bit of the what the experience is like as a student in this process. The specific IGNITE process is a basically four-component training program. The students start off with a specific pedagogy in team building, and Joy will talk to you about that, called team steps. They will go through a specific pedagogy and called problem-based learning, and Dr. Magraw will talk about that. And then they go through a clinical simulation training trials, which I will speak to, which includes a very important component, which is the debriefing station. The final component of the training is really more of a research component, and that is actually assessing the efficacy of this training. How well do the students actually learn how to work as collaborative team members? This is not a process that is quick and easy or short term. The students actually spend two full semesters in this training. And it is training that's done on top of all the other studies that they do. They come in and they do this training on Fridays and Saturdays. And it's distributed across, as I mentioned before, several months of training. And we'll walk you through that process as well. Okay, so let's start off with talking about what is Team Steps and what is that process.
Okay, so the learning objectives for the IGNITE experience focus on patient safety primarily through effective communication. So Team Steps is the teamwork and communication system that we use in all the learning experiences in the IGNITE coursework. Real-world application of Team Steps is a recurrent theme throughout the course, and we students are continually encouraged to reinforce to use Team Steps tools and strategies after receiving official Team Steps training. So, what is Team Steps? It's an evidence-based team performance system developed and field tested by the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, or AHRQ, and also the Department of Defense. So Team Steps is a teamwork and performance improvement system based on 30 years of experience in high-risk industries such as military operations, aviation, community emergency response systems, and nuclear power industries. These types of organizations have been conducting extensive research on how teams work, what makes them effective, and how to enhance their performance, especially for that safety element. I'll mention that the research is directly relevant to healthcare because delivering effective care requires teamwork. And as of 2011, so the data is a little bit dated, there are approximately 3,000 individuals who have been trained in Team Steps and 1,600 organizations throughout the country who have implemented Team Steps, including about 70% of US hospitals. So I'm wondering if anyone here has been exposed to Team Steps, has received Team Steps training. So this is exciting because it's a standardized program that can be used in different settings that once you're exposed to Team Steps, you can have a familiarity going from place to place, including hospitals. So Team Steps is designed to improve the quality, safety, and efficiency of healthcare. It incorporates best practices from the research and uses teamwork skills to lead to important team outcomes. It enables teams to adapt to changing situations, to share a common understanding of a healthcare plan, which is super important, and then to develop positive attitudes toward and appreciate the benefits of teamwork. So shifting from an individual focus to a team focus when we're providing care for patients. And this is leading to reliable and efficient care. The goal of team steps in high-risk industries such as healthcare depend on coordinated interactions of care providers working in an environment that is dynamic, complex, and high risk. So the tools and strategies used to enhance team performance across an organization, the goal is to provide highly effective teams that optimize the use of information, people, and resources to achieve the best clinical outcomes. Research on human factors, of which psychology has been a major component of, talks about that even highly skilled, motivated professionals are vulnerable to error due to human limitations. Again, I keep beating the same drum, but it's enhancing the safety and improving performance to minimize the risks that patients are exposed to. Another fundamental tenet of Team Steps is that teamwork is not innate, that it can be taught and learned. So when we think about barriers to team performance, I mentioned that human factors can lead to errors in the provision of care for patients and clients. Here's a list, and these have been found by research to be related to teamwork, communication, leadership, and decision making, all of which is important in providing care. And as we look them over, we can probably relate to a few or even more of them in our work on a daily basis. So teams undergo changes in team membership. As a student, every year going from practicum to practicum, there's always the transition and preparing patients that are in the continuity of the program to continue on despite the fact that their student therapist is moving on to another site. Lack of information sharing is another barrier. So electronic health records were created in the hopes to be able to minimize some of this inconsistency, but we can see maybe that works and maybe it doesn't work. Personal factors such as lack of time, distractions, fatigue, these are all things that we're really getting energized and talking about here about how can we do more, how can we affect more change within the same amount of time that we still have to do all of the responsibilities that we currently hold. And then interpersonal factors such as hierarchy, power dynamics, defensiveness, conflict, and misinterpretation of cues also negatively impact team performance. So there's lots of opportunities for error to occur in team-based care. On the other hand, high-performing teams enhance safety and improve performance through these characteristics identified by Salas, Stegel, and Burke's review of research on team effectiveness in organizations. So the first point, holding a shared mental model, is one of the key takeaways from the Team Steps curriculum in the Ignite program. And it provides a foundation for the points that follow. The idea is that team performance improves if team members have a shared understanding of the task that is to be performed. It's a simple concept, but sometimes simple things are not easy to implement because it acknowledges the different experiences that healthcare providers across disciplines undergo, both academically and professionally. So the bottom line is that a common understanding about and among providers is fundamental to effective collaborative practice that ultimately impacts a patient's or client's care. Teamwork cannot occur in the absence of a clearly defined team. And as Dr. Salas has been quoted to say, patient care is a team sport. So how do shared mental models help teams? Here's a closer look at the way that a shared mental model facilitates effective teamwork. It creates mutual understanding of the situation. It allows providers to communicate more effectively and develop constructive backup behaviors, such as mutual support by offering assistance to a team member in need.
These backup behaviors are founded on an understanding of each other's roles, of the team, and the ability to predict and anticipate needs. So if we look at the model a little more closely, here is an overview of how the Team Steps program and the training really works. We start from outside the triangle in. So there are three competency outcomes: knowledge, attitudes, and performance. And those are affected by the four key skills of leadership, situation monitoring, and mutual support. You'll also notice that encircling the four key skills is the patient care team that I'll get into in the next slide. The patient care team must work together effectively to implement the outcomes. So here's the patient care team, and what we in Ignite are constantly reminded of is that the patient is at the top of the pyramid and also driving as part of the team structure. So they are not a separate element of the team, but they are included in the patient care team. Below that is the core team. So the core team is the group of direct care providers across different disciplines who are working collaboratively and have the closest contact with the patient. And then contingency teams can be core team members that are focusing on a specific problem. So an emergency arises or something critical happens that demands that a smaller team kind of peel off from that core team. And then underneath that in the yellow are support elements that provide indirect services to the patient care. So really having a holistic picture of all the people that are included in providing care for a patient and how any one of these levels can affect the teamwork and function of what's happening for a patient. So here it is, the paradigm shift from an individual to a team, taking these ideas of what we're trained in a discipline-specific way and incorporating them into a model that helps us to manage our workload, improve teamwork, and improve efficiency overall so that we can serve more patients more effectively. And another way to think of this is to take a team of experts and create them into an expert team. So it's not a model to deny any one particular discipline a leadership role, but it's assuming that we're all coming together from a leadership perspective and amplifying that into a synergistic team that is working together. Really quickly, I'll just go over some of the communication tools because these are the things that we are trying to do in all of the elements, the components of the training that we go through. The call out is used to communicate important information. So it's a way to request, in this center part, it's a way to request information from other people. Sometimes it's unprompted, and what we want to do is have a closed loop of communication. That requires the cross check and the check back. So they get a little bit confusing, which is why it's really great for us to be able to practice in the different modules and especially in the simulation training. The cross check is when a request is issued that the person receiving the message acknowledges that the message was received. And the check back is from the receiver to say that the task has been completed. So it's, for example, if I have a physician in the hospital where I'm training and they ask to have a client or patient have a MOCA, then I acknowledge that I understand that this particular patient needs to receive a MOCA. And then when I finish the MOCA, I go back and I tell them that I completed the MOCA and here are the results. And then together we can decide if they need further psychological testing or how that might impact their diagnoses. And then not only being able to have the communication skills, but knowing when and how to share them. So we have lots of different opportunities in briefs, which are short sessions that are planning, to decide what the interventions are that we're going to use. Huddles are kind of like in the moment timeouts. So maybe our plan is derailing or something has come up that necessitates us to shift, so we can call a quick huddle and regroup and proceed forward from that. Debriefs are when it's all over. We can reflect and derive some lessons learned and use those to improve our teamwork in the future. And then transitions in care, anytime a patient is moving from potentially clinic to clinic or situation to situation, different simulations that we're going through, we can also have some of those. And we use I didn't actually review the S-bar, but maybe you've seen this in some notes. A lot of nurses use this to give a quick, brief information, which is the situation, here's what's going on, the background, here's what I know that might have led to the situation, the assessment, which is, here is what I think we might be dealing with, and then the recommendation is the R. So using an S-bar really quickly, if everyone's on the same page and they understand that that's how we're going to get information in, we can also make sure that we're giving all the information that we need to get out. And again, the call-outs and the checkbacks. So that's team steps in a nutshell. And I'll turn it over to Dr. Magraw to talk about problem-based learning.
Thank you.
Of information.
I'm going to have two computers up here. Are any of you familiar with problem-based learning? Yes? Okay. All right. Good. Okay. So you can chime in as we go. Let's see. Okay. So problem-based learning was initially developed for medical education. It utilizes this interprofessional team that we've been talking about that works collaboratively and is responsible really for its own learning. Okay, so basic tenets of problem-based learning are that knowledge and skills are acquired through contextual problems that are presented in sequential, cumulative, and graded in complexity manner that is those. It integrates content that is taught in the classroom with real life situations. In this case, patient vignettes that are on paper that the team is working with. And there's lots of collaboration and learning from each other on the team. Okay, so the instructors who facilitate the learning. The instructors have to put together these vignettes that they need to think about because they're going to be doing these over a period of time, so there are going to be a number of these vignettes. And so they need to be thinking about them in terms of them being sequential, cumulative, and graded in complexity over time. But in the actual hour or so that this problem-based learning experience takes place, if it's going well, the instructors actually have very little to do. If a student is not engaged or if somehow this things are kind of going off the rails in some way, then the instructor can step in and pull things back on track. And the instructor is actually more involved in process at this point than in content. Okay, so as Dr. McLean talked about, in our Ignite program, the students who are involved in this problem-based learning sitting around this circular table are first-year med students, nursing students, physical therapy, occupational therapy students, and then our psychology students. And just as an aside, I think there are about 64 students involved in the Ignite program. It's a pretty big program from the three different schools. Okay, so the way this works is case method. Students are given initial data, a short vignette on a piece of paper. Okay, and from that, they throw out ideas about what they think is going on with this patient. So this is a patient who's come into a clinic or an ER or seen in a hospital setting, and a little bit of information is given about this patient. What is going on? Okay, so the students, some of them know more, some of them know less, but they're throwing out ideas of what they think might be going on with this patient. So they are generating hypotheses. At the same time, they're also generating questions that they can use to test those hypotheses. Like if they had this information, that could rule out or this hypothesis. Not. Given today's world, they've got their electronic devices with them. So if they need to look up something, if they need to look up something in the vignette that they don't know about, a diagnosis, levels of something or other, they can do quick checks on their electronic devices. And then they get more data. Basically, they turn the page on this vignette, and there's more different new happenings that are going on with this patient. So they then generate new hypotheses, or perhaps the new data just rules out some hypotheses they had, so they can cross some hypotheses off their list. They generate more questions, more research, and then they turn the page again, and they get more information. And so they're doing this as a kind of iterative process that goes on. At the same time, they're thinking, oh, wouldn't it be nice if I knew more about whatever the topic was, diabetes in this particular context. So these are learning issues that they're going to think about researching at a later time. So they're creating a list of what they want to research later. Okay, so in this problem-based learning educational setting, typically students have 1 hour. And so they are, if they have 10 pages of this vignette where they're turning the page, they got to be on it because they don't have much time. So the way this works is they start off and they very quickly assign roles to each other. So the facilitator is the one who orchestrates the whole process. The timekeeper has to keep very strict time limits because they're going to be whipping through these pages. They assign a researcher or two to look up items, look up information about the vignettes they're given. Scribe who takes notes on a board and keeps track of the hypotheses they're working with and the questions that they want to be asking, and then also the learning issues that are arising, that are coming up. And then finally, there's one person who's specifically tasked with thinking about these learning issues that they are going to research at a later time. Okay, let's see. So this learning issue piece actually is an important part of the learning process because at the end of the hypothesis generation and they're trying to figure out what's going on with this patient, the students divide up the learning issues that have been listed on the board. Everybody chooses some area that they want to research on their own. And so when this wraps up, they go home and they do some research and they put together a handout that they then electronically share with their team members, typically several pages. And then when they next meet, maybe it's the next day, maybe it's a week later, they then all take turns teaching their team members about this learning issue. And presumably the team members have read the handout and they are up to kind of, they've taken some time with it. And so the teaching actually is not just a kind of reciting back of what's on the handout, but really highlighting the important points that they want to get across to their team members. Okay, it's a great opportunity for students to learn to be effective teachers. Okay, so why use problem-based learning? Okay, active learning is associated with greater retention of material. Also in integrated healthcare settings, health service providers, that's what we are now, right? Or health service psychologists, ideally in the integrated healthcare centers are working collaboratively as a team. And so this educational model, this problem-based learning, mimics that best practice and gives students a chance to practice engaging in this way. And it also gives students, as I said before, it also gives students practice in researching an issue and then effectively teaching that issue to others. Let's see, okay. So pros of problem-based learning. Students love learning like this. This is like a puzzle that they are figuring out with a group of people. And they are doing it collaboratively as opposed to competitively. You know, you don't get a lot of points for being the smartest in the class. Your team gets points for kind of working well together and coming to some, if not conclusions, kind of moving in the direction of figuring out what's going on. And also, students really take control of their own learning. And of course, this is guided by the clever way that the instructor has put together this vignette at this time. But students are identifying the areas, these learning issues that they want to learn more about. And you know, they are deciding what's going on, what they feel is important for them to learn. Okay. All right. There are definitely some potential difficulties with problem-based learning, and it's also a lot of work up front, putting together these vignettes, and the collaboration among the faculty on the different schools is it takes a lot of time and a lot of dedication. So a lot goes into it. You can see there's some other possible cons as well. But what I really want to end up with here is I think in an integrated healthcare setting, this is a fantastic approach. I also think that in our doctoral programs, we could be doing a lot of problem-based learning. It wouldn't be in the interprofessional realm necessarily, but in our programs, just doing this problem-based learning, I think I've listed a bunch of courses where I think it would be very easy to implement this, but I see really great possibilities for us in terms of pedagogy in the future. Okay, I'm going to stop, and with that, I'm turning it over to Dr. McLean. You don't need this, right?
Thank you, Dr. Magraw.
Yes.
So what we've experienced so far is a process of training of students in an interprofessional manner. Interprofessional students starting off with building basic skills in how to work as a team. Adding to those basic skills and how to work as a team are skills in how to develop and clinical problems and solutions as a team. So you have your team step methodology, you have your PBL, problem-based learning methodology that helps the students learn how to solve clinical problems. Now you take both of those skills, both of those approaches, and you put the students into a clinical simulation environment where the student actually applies those strategies that they've learned to solve actual clinical problems in a safe environment. So simulation is basically a technique, not a technology, to replace or amplify real experiences and guided experiences, often immersive in nature, that evoke or replicate substantial aspects of the real world in a fully interactive fashion. By GABA, and all the references are here in the presentation for your use as well. And what they're capturing in this definition is that when students are actually in the clinical simulation, they feel that they are in an actual clinical situation. They are immersed in it. They utilize all the training they've had up to that point to really try to solve these clinical problems. Now, clinical simulations probably are very much like our prior training in role-playing. in clinical work that we do. But it takes it one step further. In the clinical simulation center where we do our class, there's a broad-based set of simulations. The simple ones are the simulations with the mannequins, where you can actually train students in specific medical, nursing, physical therapy techniques. That's used a lot. But in the simulation that we do with the PsyD students, it is simulation using an actual professional actor to come into the clinical setting. There are three simulation rooms. One is the actual lab where you have the computer software to simulate whatever clinical issues you want to have going on in the setting. You're recording all the data, you're recording, you're filming the students as they're working. The second room is a room where the students and their facilitator are seated, and they are watching on the screen the students who are in the simulation center interacting with the patients. And of course, the third room is the actual simulation room for the students. The simulation settings are designed specifically to look and feel like an actual hospital or a primary care clinic. So they have clinical settings, they have ICU setting, they have a medical surge floor setting, they have an emergency room setting, and all the equipment, everything works exactly like it does in those clinical settings. Very high-tech digital equipment is utilized to do the recordings so that you have real-time playback. The students who are in the actual simulation suite have earpieces in, and the actors also have earpieces in, so the professors can actually provide additional information to the students or to the actors to make the situation more or less complicated. So a lot of work is done prior to the simulation to prepare the actor, the students, and the professors in what the simulation scene is going to be. There's going to be always a pre-simulation setting where you prepare the students to realize that this is a simulation, but assume it is as real as possible. You let them know that there's no shame in anything that's going to occur, that you do your very best, you will be supported, you never will be in danger. Then three students are typically selected to actually go into the simulation suite, and the other five or six students remain in the preparatory room and watch the simulation. The three students are given a script as to what's occurring, what the problem is, what the background situation is. They aren't told what the problem is. The actor is given a script with the actual clinical problem, and the students watching the simulation are given the full script with the full clinical problem. The simulation typically takes about 15 minutes, and during that 15-minute period of time, the students engage in problem-based learning. They engage in all the aspects of team work that they've learned. They do S-bars, they do huddles, they do debriefings, all the sort of clinical work that we need to do to work as a team occurs in those situations. After the simulation is over, the students then are brought back into the debriefing room, and they get three levels of debriefing. First of all, they get debriefing by their fellow peers who watch them, and the professor who's in the room with them, and tell them how the situation occurred, what the actual clinical problem was that they were wanting to address. They're able to pull up on the screen immediately the actual filming of them so that they can see themselves and see what they did and get feedback from that perspective. Then, very valuably, they get the feedback from the patient who comes in and actually tells them how they felt during the experience and what it was like and what cues they may have missed in terms of of identification of clinical problems they were dealing with and what they did well. The probably the most critical aspect of this whole process is the debriefing, because that's where the real learning occurs, and that's where you really engage in a very nurturing, supportive setting for the students for their debriefing. So through the course of the day, the students will start off with some teamwork. They'll start off with the teamwork training before they even start the actual day of training in the simulation. They'll do problem-based learning, then they'll go to the simulation. Some students, because we have so many students, some students have to start off the simulation and go backwards. At the close of the day, all the students go into a reflection period where they are given about 5 or 6 questions to write in terms of reflections, and we collect some additional data. So, so the simulation actually bridges from the theoretical to the clinical for all students. It allows them to engage in high-stakes sort of clinical work in a very low-exposure situation where they're still safe, the patient is safe, but they have that really rich opportunity for learning. And it allows them to utilize those skills in terms of teamwork and problem-based learning that they have learned and utilize it in a simulated situation. And of course, they get the great feedback from the professor, from the patient, from their peers, and they also have an opportunity to do it again. So it is that process of actually practicing until you get it right in a clinically supportive setting. Finally, at the close of all of this, as I mentioned before, we do collect data to say, does this really make a difference in terms of the student learning? And we have an ongoing research project that we are doing to look at that and have some grant funding for that. So the types of data that we collect include the student's self-perception of how well they've learned. By their reflection writings, they are given 5 questions that they respond to at the close of the day to reflect on what their experience was. Did they feel like they were able to learn and utilize some of the skills that they learned? There's a measure that is utilized with all students that they complete each time they go through the training, and it's called the Interprofessional Collaborative Competencies Attainment Scale, the ICAS. And it's a 20-item measure that's done on the pre-post. They take it before they do the training and after the training. That looks at 6 different competencies associated with collaborative teamwork and care management. And then finally, the sort of summative measure of all of this is the actual expert rating of how well the students did in the clinical situation. And that's called the KITSIM Team Performance Scale. And what happens is that the professors, researchers, and go through a training process to actually rate and train the videotapes of the students. They rate the video of the students in the simulation, and they also rate the video of the students in the feedback session to see whether or not the students giving feedback actually provided supportive, nurturing feedback that was instructive, and also how well the students did in this in the actual simulation center. The publication of these data is in process. We're collecting data, and by the end of this year, we'll have enough data to begin to finish writing up. There have been a number of presentations and publications from this work. This work has been ongoing at Samuel Merritt University and at the Joint Medical School for the last 3 years. The PsyD program was added to the program this year. And so they're very excited to have now behavioral health clinical psychology as a part of the interprofessional team and a part of the training. So stepping back, perhaps what you're seeing and what's important to sort of emphasize is that we are now in the throes of really understanding that integrated healthcare is here to stay, that it makes a significant difference, particularly in the primary care settings, and that those differences are measurable with respect to actual cost savings in ED visits, inpatient hospital stays. They are measurable with respect to patient satisfaction. They are measurable with respect to actual satisfaction of providers. And everyone is looking to bring on board an integrated healthcare team, particularly clinical psychologists and MFTs, to fulfill that role on the team, which is critical. However, there's not a lot of training to prepare psychologists, physicians, or other allied health professionals to work in as a team. So there's a big mandate to provide interprofessional education as a preparation for integrated healthcare. And so that's what this work is all about, not validating integrated healthcare, but actually preparing future healthcare workers to work in a collaborative fashion as a team. So I think the final component of this presentation is really to engage you as an audience in terms of, do you have any experience in this area? Is this something that makes sense for your setting? Any thoughts regarding that? Anyone? And perhaps we can rove the mic around. Since this is a recording, we probably want to capture anyone who may have some comments. Dr. Rodriguez Menendez? Could you? Yeah, we need to record everything.
I certainly think that there are aspects of this that can be incorporated in the training of our students. It might not be with a computer simulation room, although that would be ideal. It might not be with patient actors, which would be ideal as well. But certainly, as Dr. McGraw was talking, with vignettes in terms of comparison and in an interdisciplinary fashion, the important thing is to teach students to work together as a team collaboratively. So it is a process that needs to unfold. So I could see that this could be applied very easily with thought, but in a clinical program.
I've seen a number of programs that are doing interprofessional teaching and learning and training. What I'm interested in knowing is, what do you all teach in terms of power dynamics in the team? And so, is it interprofessional? Is it or interdisciplinary? Is it collaborative, or is it some parallel process where everybody's their own silo and we just look across the gulf and wave? Or how do you all figure out the power dynamics? Is there somebody in charge of the team? How do you decide? Who decides? Who has the last decision-making step? Or
excellent question. And that comes up all the time, and that's something that we work on a lot in the team process. And a lot of it has to do with probably reinforcing and supporting and encouraging non-physicians to take the team leader role. We've had simulations where the nurse practitioner really was the lead, should have been the lead. And we had a classic example in the last simulation we did where the nurse practitioner had a plan, laid it out, everybody was on the board with it. The physician student came in the door and she stepped back and said, "What do you think?" And so the big debriefing at that point was, you're the team leader. You had the plan, you had the expertise, your plan was clear, the team was supportive of it. When the physician comes in the room, do not step back. And so it's a learning process. It's a very dynamic, organic process, and it is not going to change very quickly, because we've had a culture of delineating physicians as team leaders for so many years that a lot of unlearning will have to occur. But yes, the professors model that very, very well, that we rotate team leadership depending on what the clinical issue is. Oftentimes what is said is who really leads the team. If it's a behavioral health issue, if we have a clinical vignette where one of the complications was that the patient was sort of end stage from cancer, and there was evidence that she was experiencing depression. So the psychologist really needed to lead the team in terms of how to manage the depression for an end stage patient. So it rotates depending on the clinical presentation, but it takes a while to get students to actually embrace that and learn that. Joy.
So to your question about the social dynamics and how it all kind of plays out, what's really exciting and also a little bit scary is that the faculty allow us to kind of muddle our way through. So for example, in problem-based learning, there was a scenario where a doctor of physical therapy student was sharing an example in her training with a particular physician, and she kind of had a microaggression and said, they think they're God's gifts to the earth and to the world. And so it's, like I said, exciting and anxiety provoking for us, as especially psychology students in a culturally diverse program, to kind of think about how to engage those situations and provide leadership in a way to affect dialogue and deconstruct some of those preconceived notions that we have in society. Something that's been really impactful for me in this program is to think about the use of the term doctor, right? Because my whole life I've thought of being a doctor as a physician, and going through a doctoral program myself and anticipating that I will soon be a doctor, that changes the way that I address other professionals at the same level. And so really being conscious of calling physicians physicians. The other component of it is that we are at different levels in our training, but the medical students that we're working with are first year students. Some of the other disciplines are a little bit more advanced, but in a way, most of the psychology students are more advanced in our training programs, and so that allows us a space to assert ourselves as leaders and maybe not necessarily take a backseat to the clinical cases that come up. The other piece of it is that we're able to bring up dynamics that aren't necessarily considered in those other professions, like social support networks or socioeconomic status, all the different diversity elements that we think of beyond race and gender, to be able to have a conversation about who this person is rather than just following a protocol and executing what we might do on the plan. So in that way, it is really collaborative, but the faculty allow us to, in a safe, engaging way, have those conversations.
One of the things that the faculty from the joint medical program at UCSF and UC Berkeley have done is to insist that the first year medical students go through this program so as to mitigate the likelihood that they're going to sort of leave the program with the idea that they are leaders. They are the leaders of the healthcare setting. So they learn from the beginning that this is a shared responsibility. A great question. Other questions, observations?
When you had your pyramid, you had the patient at the top of the pyramid. Where does the family come into play?
Patient, family are both at the top.
One and the same.
Yes. And it is strongly emphasized that the patient family is at the top of the pyramid and a part of the team.
What is the cost of the simulation laboratory?
Can you repeat that?
The question is, what is the cost of the simulation laboratory? This simulation laboratory is probably one of the most pristine around, and it's utilized by most of the schools in the area. So easily more than 1.3 million has been put into this, but it's not only just a simulation laboratory, it is classrooms around it and all of the equipment that's in it. All the equipment utilized is this hospital-grade equipment so as to give a real sense of how everything operates.
I just have to say, it's very cool. It is, and I mean, it really looks, when you walk into one of those simulation rooms, it looks like you're walking into, you know, a hospital or primary care clinic or an ER room or whatever. It is state of the art.
So what do you guys think is the next iteration? You're here, and this part of this conference is about futuring. So what is the future, perhaps, of evolving this particular training model? Since you may already be thinking about the strengths and relative limitations of it.
Well, I do really think that there is a future for us in our pedagogy in doctoral programs teaching this stuff. I think the professor sitting behind the desk kind of lecturing about psychopathology and all the different disorders, you know, students can look that up on their phones. I mean, I think this lends itself incredibly easily, the problem-based learning part, to that. I listed a whole bunch of courses I thought could work well. So I think that's one real clear takeaway from this. But you might be thinking larger, because you often do think larger.
Well, I have consulted at a school where the work is done with real patients, live patients, and there's an interdisciplinary team. If somebody presses a button and everybody goes and does their function, and then they come back and they debrief, the med students and the nurses and the psychology trainees. I mean, it's a different model. I wouldn't say it's any better or worse. But I'm just wondering, have you all really thought about that? The other model is some of our schools have clinics, psychology clinics. So, you know, why can't some of these other professions come over to our shop and mm-hmm. see our clients in our settings and figure out a way to do interprofessional experience in that way?
I think it's a brilliant idea. In fact, one of the areas that I am strongly supportive of is actually the sort of, some people call it the reverse integrated healthcare, but it's basically taking integrated healthcare principles and applying them in community mental health centers. As all of you in this audience probably realize, that people with schizophrenia and manic depressive illness, more the severe mental illnesses, die 25 years early, not because of the psychiatric problems. It's because of the diabetes, the hypertension, the mismanagement of a number of chronic health conditions. So bringing the expertise of primary care into a mental health setting could actually enhance the overall care and lifespan of those patients. So that'd be a wonderful training model for students to experience that, and also a great training model for nurse practitioners and physicians to go into those settings.
Do you want to talk about some of that community mental health work that you're doing?
I think what Dr. McGraw is referring to is a project that we have ongoing in what is called East Oakland, where we are actually creating a broader-based community network of services for underserved communities that is has a faith-based sort of emphasis, where you have a center and then you have spokes. In the center is basically case management services, support services, sort of the healthy wellness sort of services that most primary care clinics can't provide because it costs. But a faith-based center may have that. In East Oakland, there's a large African-American church that has case managers, it has job placement, it has a gym, it has nurses that students that do nutritional counseling. And then by utilizing that as a core for the healthy wellness sorts of things, then you have spokes out to the federally qualified healthcare clinics that can provide the ongoing primary care. And it's fed by the students in universities. Again, semi-merit universities, nursing students, and their podiatry students actually provide services in this church setting. Then the actual federally qualified health clinics in the area, lifelong clinic, like clinical clinic, actually have the ongoing care of the patients. So it's more sort of integrated training opportunity for students, but it also provides a tremendous amount of service to the community at large. And I think that sort of model can be replicated in lots of large urban settings, especially within the African American community that has a very, or Latino communities that have very strong faith-based, strong infrastructure. We are over our time, but thank you so much for your attention this afternoon and for your support of this work. And we are available if you have any additional questions afterwards. Thank you.
Thank you.